I'd just like to say too how much I appreciate my wife Anne coming with me. And I appreciate her very, very much. Tonight I'd like to speak about a subject that's really helped me fundamentally grasp the things of the Spirit. I didn't just fall into the things of the Spirit. I learned them. You can develop your spirit man or woman just like you can develop your natural person. And I want to talk about the natural man and the spirit man and faith. And I want to endeavor to link them together tonight, God helping me. Man is the only creature on earth that is created to live in two realms. That we are a natural being and we relate to this natural world, but we are created a spirit. You and I are a spirit, we have a soul, and we live inside of a body. The one that I can see is not the real you. The real you is on the inside. I can see your house, but you live on the inside. If you go to some places, as a person passes away, they'll say, he or she is gone. That's the truth, they're gone. They left. The real person goes. Your spirit is your inner life, the very center of you, the inner person, the real you, deep on the inside. And it's your spirit that needs to be born again. In fact, Jesus said, you must be born again, or you cannot even see the kingdom of heaven, let alone enter it. Well, I added, let alone enter it. He put full stop after you can't see it. The natural person, well, we're familiar with that. I have a mind, a natural mind, natural emotions. I can do natural things. I can drive a car. I can do all sorts of things with my natural self, as you can with yours. We are made natural to live in this natural world, and we're all familiar with that. We are made a spirit being, and Australia, by and large, is not so familiar with that truth, but it is the truth. I'm a man. I'm not a woman. I'm a man. Never been tempted to put on Anne's dress, nor do I wear her lipstick. I'd rather get her lipstick by other means. More enjoyable means. And I like it a lot. So I keep on getting it, and she wears out lipsticks all the time. But I'm a man. I don't have to get up of a morning and confess I'm a man, I'm going to be a man today. I am a man. It's normal for me to think like a man. Abnormal for me to think like a woman. I'm not quite sure how they think. But I think like a man. It is normal for me to be spiritual because I am a spirit. You are a spirit. And as you develop an awareness that you are a spirit, you don't have to become spiritual. You are a spirit. How much more spiritual can you be than spirit? But most people that I've met, many anyhow, are trying to be more spiritual. And they endeavor to be more spiritual by reading the Bible, by praying, very good things to do, by going to church and charismatic meetings, all sorts of things, and we endeavor to be more spiritual. All very good things to do. But you are a spirit. You were created a spirit. You were given a soul and you live inside of a body. When I realized that, I knew it as a doctrine, but when I realized it as truth, and I started to become aware of it, And I began to practice being aware of it. And alone with God, I would let my awareness faculty, which is a faculty of your spirit, and you allow that awareness faculty to become aware of truth. And truth sets you free. But it's a living truth that sets you free, not doctrinal truth. It is necessary to know good doctrine. Every word you say about God is doctrine. Doctrine is knowledge about God. That's what doctrine is. And you all have a lot of doctrine. And I do too. But doctrine doesn't change you. Realize truth in the inner part of your life, that changes you. That's why meditation is so important. In one of the sessions, I think it's in School of the Spirit, but we've run out of them, there I talk about meditation. And it would be good for you to get it if you don't understand biblical meditation. Well, the Spirit has every function that my natural man has. I can see things with my natural eyes. I can see things with my spirit. If you were here last night or the night before, most likely I said it, and most likely I'll say it tonight. I was saying it as during that prayer line this morning. I said, oh, God's going to bless you now. Because he'd opened my eyes in the spirit, and I could see a shaft of light coming down, or sometimes a cloud coming down. I am watching what the Spirit of God's doing. So, oh, it's going to fall on you now, I'll say, because it still often catches me by surprise and it just pops out of my mouth. Because it's good that the realm of the Spirit is not far away. It's here. It's just a different realm. We are surrounded by the realm of the Spirit. Angels are round about us. He gives his angels charge over us individually. There's a lot of us here tonight. There'd be 1,000 angels at least here tonight. It's just, are you aware of the spiritual realm? Are you aware how inhabited it is? I don't mean doctrinally, I mean in reality. Have you ever, alone with God, let truth instill in your soul and say, God, angels are with me? And you realize it until it becomes your reality. I live with angels. Angels are my friends. We all know, if you're a Pentecostal, the devils are around. I wonder, do we know equally that angels are around? But they are around. It's just that they're not often realized. They're our servants. They're certainly not our footmat. They are wonderful beings created by God, but they're here to serve us. I think if they're given to many Christians, all their life the Christian never gives them a job to do. They must be bored out of their tree. And when the person finally dies, they thank God, I might get a better one next time. At least recognizes my help I gave them. I ask the angels of God to help me all the time. I ask them to come into healing meetings with me. I ask God, I need all the help I can get. I am a needy man. You may not need it, but I need it. Every angel God can spare, let him come my way. Let them help me. Bring a heavenly atmosphere into a meeting. Charge the meeting with heaven's glory. May they reflect the person of Jesus Christ over a meeting. Anyhow, it's the realm of the Spirit. The spirit man, woman, your spirit, is able to do so many things. It can, like my hand, can reach out to the extent of my arm, and I can take something. Like I take this bottle of water and lift it up. Isn't that clever? In the same way, by the grace of God, I wrecked your carpet, Raph. Beautiful carpet too. Brand new, I believe. In the same way, as you become familiar with the realms of God, you can reach into the realm of the Spirit and take the healing gift of God and place it on somebody. And not only place it on them, but place it into them. You can do things in the Spirit because you're created for that. It's our inheritance. We are sons and daughters of the living God. We are joint heirs with Jesus Christ. The realm of heaven is our realm. The realm of heaven will come and join you on earth. And how blessed it is when it manifests itself around you. Heaven is not far away, it's simply another realm. When you start to move in the Spirit, your natural mind, if it's like mine, will get in your way. And it stops many people from moving in the Spirit. Your natural mind is not your spirit. Your natural mind belongs to your natural person. I have a saying, I believe it's totally true. It is perfectly spiritual to be natural. And it's perfectly natural to be spiritual. Because God made me natural. Natural is not bad, not evil. Natural is how God made me. To eat a feed of steak, onions and eggs, what a brilliant meal. It's natural. God made me natural. And it's perfectly spiritual to be natural, to have a game of football. My games of football are past now, but have a game of football, to ride a horse, to do whatever you want to do, drive a big truck. And you are inhabited by the Spirit of God. So as you drive a big truck, you can be in the Spirit driving that truck. Just like when I'm starting to move on this altar tonight, I'll be in the Spirit. But I'm in the Spirit now. I'll be in the Spirit when I wake up in the morning. It is perfectly natural to be in the Spirit because we are spirit people. It's perfectly spiritual to be natural because we are natural people. The church, in parts of the church, I'm not against the church, I'm for the church. Everybody who loves Christ, I'm for it. No matter what the brand is on the door, as long as Christ is on the inside. So, the natural man will try to be spiritual. The natural man tries. And if ever you find yourself trying to be spiritual, you're in the natural man. The natural man cannot be spiritual. The natural man can do natural things. The Spirit is spiritual where it is a spirit. The Quakers used to call it centering in. And they would have meetings where they'd center in to their inner being, their spirit. And the Spirit of God would move. And in those early Quaker meetings, they had amazing moves of the Spirit. I call it dropping down from here to here. For I formed the man in the midst of him, Zechariah 12:1 says. So that out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. This spake he of the Spirit, Jesus said. I formed the Spirit. So the very center of my being, my inward self, is my spirit formed by God, will live forever. You can't kill a spirit. That's why you will never die. That's why the Bible says when you're born again, you've passed from death to life. You'll never die. Your body will, but you won't. You'll just move to another address. You change address. That's all you do. And you keep living. You won't die for a second, a half a second, anything. You'll never know death because you've passed from death to life. So we'll just go to live with God and all that heaven is got for us. But by trying to be spiritual, people put on a spiritual language. And there's nothing wrong with nice language. I hope we're not rough hillbillies, but they put on, oh, brother, hallelujah, brother. And you can tell it's like syrup. It's the natural person trying to be spiritual. If you watched them when they weren't trying to be spiritual, you'd see the real person. A natural person can try to be spiritual, but all they can ever be is religious. And all religion comes from a natural person trying to be spiritual, acting spiritual. That's why they can have a fight on the way to church. But when they arrive, they can smile and say, God bless you, brother. God bless you, sister. And keep their argument till the church is over and then continue. A natural person trying to be spiritual is just religious. It hasn't come to the depth of the inner being, for it's out of your inward man. The spirit is called the inward man in 2 Corinthians 4:16, I believe. It's called the hidden man of the heart in 1 Peter 3:4, or hidden woman of the heart, whichever. So the hidden person, you are a total person in the spirit. The Bible says, as a person thinks in their heart, so they are. The heart and the spirit are interchangeable words, in my terms. So as I think in my spirit, that's who I really am. So my spirit can think. My spirit can reason with God. My spirit can commune with God in thought. I can think with God. I can be with God. I can commune with Him alone or in company. My spirit is born to relate to God. It is not unusual for your spirit to want communion with the Spirit of the living God. You are created so that the Spirit of God would dwell in your spirit and live inside of you. I said that the natural man might be in your way when you try to become, move in the Spirit and do the gifts of the Spirit. And at the start, I thought my natural mind was my biggest trouble. And at that time, it was. But it wasn't the trouble that I thought it was. I discovered my natural mind. I started to hear from God, and God would tell me things to do. For instance, one of them, not that long after I started to operate in the word of knowledge, it was still new to me, somewhat scary, but incredibly wonderful, exciting, scary, yes. And I was going to a home meeting to speak at a home meeting, about 8 people, I suppose, at the home meeting. And as I was going there, I said, Lord Jesus, give me a word of knowledge. I was practicing, you know. I just wanted another word of knowledge because it was fun. And he said to me these words. There's a man there. He has a steel plate in his head and a screw is loose. I said, God, there's only about 8 people there. The chances of that being right are very remote. And being a man of faith, after considering it for a few moments, I said, Lord, give me another word of knowledge. But if you know God at all, you will know that God has an ability to go silent that is incredible. And the silence that He gives you, the silent treatment, is total. And you know He is not going to say one more thing until you do what He said. And He gave me that treatment. I had a miserable time getting to that home meeting. It was miserable. I was wondering, how am I going to get out of this? What am I going to do? I thought, there's no way somebody there's got a steel plate in his head and a screw's loose. But there was no way out of it. I was stuck. And so I turned up, being a mighty man of faith. And I made all the back doors. I said, look, I'm very new at this. And perhaps I'm totally wrong. But on the chance that I did hear from God, there is a person here, I think, God told me, but I may have been wrong, who has a steel plate in your head and a screw's loose. I felt silly saying it. And the man said, "That's me." He said, "I'm going for an operation next week." And I thought I had my chance to be famous, and I blew it. Your natural mind can get in the way of the spirit. And for ages, my natural mind would tell me, "Don't say that. You'll be stupid. You'll look silly. That couldn't be right. You look foolish." The first time ever I moved in the spirit, I have no idea what I told you last year, so if I'm repeating myself, somebody wave at me and I'll get off the subject. But somebody was flying me to Melbourne to speak. First time anybody had flown me anywhere to speak. Big deal. So I was flying on this aeroplane down there, and I was saying, "God," I was wanting the word of knowledge. I'd been wanting it for about a year. I'd fasted a huge amount that year. I'd prayed. I'd put myself through rigid spiritual disciplines, all trying to get God to give me a word of knowledge. Towards the end of that year, and before I went down to Melbourne, I'd said to God, "I know why people don't move in the spirit that much. It's too blimmin' hard." I thought, what more do you want of me, you know, like? I would have made a good Pentecostal monk crawl on broken glass if only God would give me words of knowledge. And as I was going down, I was bored in the plane. I was usually bored in a plane. I don't like them much, except they're quick. And so I was sitting there, and I opened my Bible, and I thought, if only it was easy. And there's an envelope in my Bible, and the thought came to me, "Sore right knee." And I thought, if only it was easy like that, I wrote down "sore right knee." And then another thought came and I wrote it down, another one. I filled up both sides of that envelope and I closed my Bible up, and thank God the envelope was in it. And I thought, if only it was easy like that. And I went back to seeking God for a word of knowledge. That night I stood up to preach, and there was a few hundred people there, and I'd never been there before, never been in Melbourne before. And as I stood up to preach, I announced my text, and my mind went blank. I mean, it went blank. It was stripped of everything. Couldn't think of a thing. And I felt embarrassed, so I had to say, "Look, I'm really sorry. My mind just went blank." I announced my subject again, and my mind was as blank as a black slate. Nothing. I apologized again. I saw the pastor sitting forward on the seat. My brain said, "He's going to throw you out any minute now." And I announced it a third time. And a third time, there was nothing anywhere in me. It was like I was empty. I had nothing. God was gone. Nothing was around me. Nothing. I was so embarrassed. And I said, "Holy Spirit, what am I going to do?" He said, "The envelope." And my brain said, "You're in enough trouble now. Don't read that out." But I found myself saying, quite apart from myself, "Well, obviously God doesn't want me to preach just now. On the way down here in the aeroplane, God was speaking to me." And I was listening to myself say it like I was a foreigner. It was like I was divorced from myself. And I said, "There's a person here and you've got a bad right knee and it's very painful." And the man jumped up and said, "That's me." And he came out and I thought, wow, I got out of that. And the man came out and he was limping. And my mind said, "Don't be a fool. You've never got anybody healed yet. He won't get healed. You look silly." Your natural mind might give you a trouble as you start to move in the things of the Spirit. At least mine gave me a trouble. Well, I prayed for him. The power of God fell on him. He was on the floor. Everybody was surprised, including me. And he jumped up and he flicked his leg around. He said, "I'm healed." He said, "I'm healed." And then I had a dilemma. Will I risk it with a second one? Now, if God can use a fool like me, he could sure use you. you couldn't be worse than I was. It would be impossible. You couldn't be. You'd have to be a total idiot to be worse than me. And God used me. He spoke through an ass once. Are you at least equal with a donkey? If you are, you'll do. I'm telling you this tonight. The natural mind is for this natural world. Just tell it to mind its own business. You have a mind of the Spirit as you think in your heart. You're going to drop into the Spirit. And that to me was a wonderful secret when I learned that. To drop into the realm of the Spirit, because I've allowed the realm of the Spirit to be so preeminent in my life. And I fellowship with the Holy Spirit. I worship God Almighty and the throne of the universe. But I fellowship with God who lives inside of me. Christ in you is the hope of glory. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who dwells in you. You have fellowship with him there in the Spirit and have sweet communion. He said, I will never leave you, nor will I ever forsake you. That's including in your bad times, in the dark days. He said, I'll never leave you. He knows all about you and he saved you anyhow. He knows every mistake you were ever going to make and he saved you anyhow. He loved you anyhow. He'll love you during your mistake. He will love you everywhere. He is a marvelous person. God is the nicest person in the entire universe and the ultimate kindest person. And he loves you. And that's a wonderful thing. So to be natural is okay. I was trying to get rid of my naturalness to be more spiritual. You can't do that. God made you natural. For a purpose, to live in this natural world. You don't have to swear and carry on like a jackass. You can be a refined, natural person, and you can display the presence of Christ in your naturalness, of course. And so we should. But I am a spirit. And as a spirit being, as I get to know my spirit, and allow the realm of the Spirit to become my realm, where I'm at home in that realm almost more than I'm at home in the natural realm. And I can fellowship with God in the realm of the Spirit and listen to him speak to me. God speaks in all sorts of ways. He can speak by vision, by dream. He can speak out of the Word of God. He can speak directly to your heart. He can give you impressions. A sense of knowledge, often very faint, is how he speaks with me. All sorts of ways God can talk, but it'll be spirit to spirit God speaks, and he'll speak into your spirit. So I couldn't impress on you more than I could impress on you to become aware of your spirit, man or woman, your inner life, and to spend time developing an awareness of the inner life. If it's strange to you at the start, persist. Learning one and one make two was strange at one time. Now you just rattle it off. Driving your car at one time in the natural was very difficult. If you lived in my day, you had to have a clutch. And you had to put the clutch in and put the brake on and put the accelerator down and keep the thing on the road and not look where you're putting your feet. He had to do all these complicated things. We had a lot of one-way bridges in Australia when I was young. And they looked very narrow when you're first learning to drive. But now I just spin across whatever, go anywhere, do anything. It's second nature to me now. When I started to move in the Spirit, it seemed very awkward, very complicated, very, very tedious. I wasn't aware of my spirit man. I didn't even know I had one at one stage of my life. Even after I got saved, I just wasn't aware of it. I was just aware of me, and I had to be a Christian. So I was calling my natural man me. And I am a natural man, but I am a spirit. So become aware of your inner life, because it's there that God will speak to you. It's there that God will empower you. It's there where the blessed Holy Spirit lives. He is joined to your spirit. He's not joined to your brain. He's joined to your spirit. And spirit to spirit he speaks. So it's from out of those wells of salvation comes the water of life. And you can bless other people out of the spirit. And the God will come down upon people. He'll flow out of you unto people. God will do everything. And as you become sensitive, you know, you can be very, very sensitive to things, or you can be quite oblivious of things. You can become sensitive. I was a horseman, a cattleman, and I could be chasing wild cattle at a flat gallop through the bush, and I knew what those cattle were going to do. I got to know cattle. I could understand them, and I knew if they were going to turn even before they'd turn. I knew what a horse was going to do. You could watch his ears, and you know when he was bucking which way he was going to turn next. You become sensitive to the animal you're riding or the animals you're chasing. You can become sensitive to people. You can become sensitive to atmospheres. Atmospheres live in houses where people dwell. And you can become sensitive. And you think, oh, bad atmosphere here. Or whatever. Or this is a beautiful place. And your spirit feels good. You can become sensitive to God's presence. It's only a learned faculty. It's a faculty of the spirit. As we learn, we will make mistakes. A man who never made a mistake never made anything. It's all right to make a mistake, but don't keep on repeating it. Learn from it. Do better next time. Be quick to apologize if you made a mistake. Be held accountable for what you do. And that way you won't make the same mistake too many times. God doesn't mind us making a mistake. God loves us. We're his children. Even if you've got a PhD, when you come to God, you're his child. So the natural man is for the natural world, and the spirit man is for the spirit realm. So we drop down into our spirit. Now it's from the spirit that we really develop such a great awareness of God. Now faith is a thing of the spirit. All spirit atmospheres and abilities are in the spirit. When the Holy Spirit came into your life, he brought all of his character and all of his abilities. They're all in you. Have I learned to work in them all yet? No, I haven't. I've become familiar with many of his ways, and some of his ways I'm not yet familiar with. I would think you'd be much the same. When you become familiar with one of his ways, the danger is that you stop there and you say, well, God hasn't given me that gift yet. Well, no, I'd like to say you haven't developed that ability yet. So you and I can develop in God, grow up in Christ in all things. The Thessalonican people grew in faith exceedingly. Others might grow slowly, and others barely see a movement. I would like to grow exceedingly. So it's a growth, it's a development. God's really wonderful. It's an exciting adventure. I say that God is the only person big enough that a big man or a woman, I mean big in their spirit, will never reach the end of God. You never come past a challenge to know God, for God is infinite. We know a little bit of God, but it's wonderful, and it makes you feel wonderful. God is an incredible person. So I can develop the arena of my spirit, and I can develop the abilities of the Holy Spirit. How do you do it? You start by desiring it. Jesus said, whatsoever things you desire, Mark 11:23-24, whatsoever things you desire, when you pray, believe you receive them. Oh, so I don't pray for them. As I am praying, I am receiving into myself, into my being, the ability to do thus and so that I'm desiring. And I keep on believing and receiving. I think a big mistake I made in my life, I asked for it. And I wanted God to give it to me full blown. Because He's God. And God can do anything. So I asked to get healed, so I expect to get healed. And you can get healed. I asked to move in the Spirit, I expected Him just to do it. I didn't realize that I have a part in this thing. We are workers together with Christ. And Jesus Christ comes into us by His Holy Spirit. Oh, thank God for the Holy Spirit. And He works with us and He educates us spiritually. And He'll train us if we allow Him. If I put myself in His way, I've broken in a lot of horses. We had 148 horses on the cattle station that I grew up on. Most of them, nearly all of them, were Brumbies. We called wild horses and broke them in. And I broke in all of them. And so I'd train those horses. Now, I'd love to train a horse so he'd trust me that I could gallop him at a rail fence and at the last moment touch the rein with my little finger and he'd slide and whip around and hit him and he'd go again down the other way at a flat gallop. But he didn't do that the first time, nor the second time, nor the 15th time, but he'd do it. I had my own horses. Every man had 8 horses that we own horses. And my 8 horses, they were hobbled out, you know, no horse paddocks in the bush when you're mustering wild cattle. They were hobbled out at night. And I could call my horses and they'd come to me. They were my friends. I never hurt them. They trusted me. I slept on the ground. I had a bush net to keep the mozzies off. And in the night, in the middle of the night, a couple of my favorite horses would often come up and nuzzle the stick he had in the ground, a cross peg to hold the bush net, and he'd nuzzle it. He wanted me to get up and rub his nose. And so I would. We were friends. But he was once a Brumby stallion. He wasn't once looking for me to rub his nose. He'd snort at me and rear up on his hind legs in the breaking-in yard. But we became friends. You and the Holy Spirit, He found you. But you were most likely lost. Most likely, if you were like me, you were trained by the devil to do stuff. I don't mean I was devilish, but I did a lot of crazy things. I was discipled in the wrong way, by the wrong spirit. And then Jesus came. And I expected, well, God will do anything. I had no concept that God was going to train me like I used to train horses. That I would develop in the things of the Spirit. And I wouldn't have even known how to develop. I would have read the Bible more, prayed more, so asked God for the gifts more. But no, when the Spirit of God came, He brought all His gifts with Him. All His abilities with Him. For the Holy Spirit is God. God the Holy Spirit. God the Holy Spirit lives inside of you. And God has got all of His abilities. And He trains me to work with Him so that I can be a worker, co-worker with Christ who needs not be ashamed. And it took a time. But it took me time to train my horses. It took my dad time to train me to be a stockman. It took time to learn to ride a buck jumper. It took time to do anything I've ever done in my life. Why should the spirit realm be any different? But when that understanding comes in, at least in my spirit, that the Spirit of God would train me. And he trained me largely by creating this desire in me. And I fostered the desires. I built those desires to know God, to walk with God, to move in faith, to see impossibilities become possible. I dreamed of it. I'd think about it. I'd talk about it. I'd be in amongst it. I'd just say there, dreaming of it, trying, sometimes failing, sometimes succeeding. When I'd succeed, I'd go home and think with the Holy Ghost about it and say, Holy Spirit, what did I do right? What did I do? You know, the whole of the pressure of your city is in a pipe out there, but it's not flooding the ground. The tap is turned off. But you could go out there and turn the tap on, and the entire pressure of the water of this city would come out of that pipe. The mighty God lives in you. And as I come into alignment with him, then his Spirit can flow through me to the degree I come into alignment. How good is God? So I don't have to be an expert overnight. This is not an overnight thing. Now, you might have an overnight experience. I've had many where I thought, my God, from now on it'll be easy. I need to find. That was a wonderful experience, but now, God, where are you now? I had to learn that he was training me to walk with him, training me to be sensitive to his Spirit, like I trained my horses to be sensitive. Training me. My mate Kevin here was a farmer. I don't know, you ever worked draft horses? You would have worked them? I've broken in one draft horse. Crazy idea, but they come and you just get the long rein and you flick it. Get up, whatever you say. He recognized the voice, and if he was an old trained horse, he'd lay under the collar and he'd go. If it was a young horse that you were training, he'd push into the collar and wear himself out in the first hour. But I had an old draft horse called Prince. And he'd say, get up, Prince. And he'd just lean into the collar and pull the slide with drums of milk on it or something, or the plow. He'd go all day long, just steady, good horse. But he didn't start like that. I had to learn the moods of the Spirit, the instruction of the Spirit. So I sensitized my spirit to the Holy Spirit. I still do. I will often alone with God saying, Holy Spirit, I sensitize my spirit to you. Just be so sensitive that I can feel your slightest mood. I can feel the change of your mood. I can sense it when you want me to go here or there, or what you want me to do. Blessed Holy Spirit, let me be so sensitive. And I would consciously endeavor to sensitize my inner life to the Holy Spirit. Do you do that much? If you don't, you ought to. Because we are a spirit being, and God is a spirit, and we need to become sensitive to him. So being a spirit person is the most exciting and rewarding and blessed life that there ever could be. I'm here to say that without qualification. God is the only one big enough that a big person will never come to the end of him. There's always another challenge. So it's a development, it's a growth into the different gifts of the Spirit. And you get there partly by desiring. Whatsoever things you desire, when you pray, believe you receive them, and you shall have them. Should be a major verse, Mark 11:23, verse 24. Therefore I say unto you, whatsoever things you believe, anyhow, it's gone from me. I know the verse well, but he said, you will have whatsoever you say, if you believe that what you say will come to pass. When we built COC, wasn't that one of our favorite verses? It was. And we saw God move across this country. We would say it, and say it, and say it, and say it, not like a parrot, but spiritually, intentionally, we would say it. You speak out of your spirit. You're speaking from the Holy Ghost. You're declaring it. Some people today would say you're prophesying it. You're saying it. You're creating it by the words of the mouth that come from the Holy Ghost. For he's joined to your spirit. And if he's joined to your spirit, it's hard for you to be alone. Not everything you say comes from him, but when it comes from him, it's powerful. Words are powerful. Your words will become pregnant with the power to perform themselves when they come from the Spirit of God. That's a profound statement, and it's very true. So the person of the Spirit, to understand I am a spirit, that the Spirit of God has come and joined himself to my spirit, and now I'm going to be trained by him. And Lord, these are the gifts that I believe you want me to have. So as I pray, I desire them and I believe and I receive them. And I receive them into my spirit. And then for me, I confess, Lord, as I need these gifts, they will manifest themselves. They will just come to me. The Bible says in 1 John 2:20, You have received an anointing from the Holy One, and you know all things. When I read that, I said, that's not true. I don't know much at all. But in the Spirit, I knew all things. I just didn't know what I knew. And that's what that means. For the Spirit of God has come into me and into you. So you know all things. You just got to tap that knowledge. The knowledge is in him. It's not in me. It's in him, but he's in me. And when he who is my life shall appear, Colossians 3:4 says, I'll be like him. So his life is in me and he knows everything. He knows everything about you. Everything, everything. So if I tap his knowledge about you, then I will know what he chooses to let me know. I will not know what he doesn't choose to let me know. So it all makes sense. I hope I'm not being complicated. It almost makes perfect sense. Why, it's natural to be spiritual. It's natural. The Spirit of God has come into me. I can't see him. My natural man shouldn't look for him. Because my natural man, 1 Corinthians 2:14 says, the natural man understandeth not the things that be of the Spirit of God, neither can he know them. They are foolishness to him. They are spiritually discerned or understood. Does that make sense? Let me repeat that verse. The natural man, you are a natural person, man, woman. You are natural. The natural part of you understandeth not the things that be of the Spirit of God, neither can you know them. You can know theology. You can know Bible. With your natural man. You can pass all your exams with your natural man in Bible college. Doesn't mean you know it. It just means you intellectually know it. The natural man understandeth not the things that be of the Spirit. Neither can he know them. They're foolishness to him. They are spiritually discerned. When I found that verse and I discovered other things, it made so much sense to me. I said, that's why my mind gives me so much trouble. It seems foolishness to my mind. Like, what makes sense about laying your hands on a man that is sick and talking to the sickness and telling it to go away? Now, can you tell me one sensible thing about that? To your natural head, there's nothing sensible. It was only a few weeks ago, I was on Bribie Island. I was in a CFC on Bribie Island. And I had this meeting and all these people there. Many people got healed. And I came to one man, he had a big stick. And I said to him, and what did God do for you? He said, nothing yet. I said, oh, because they were out testifying, but he got in the line. I said, what do you want God to do? He said, I've got Parkinson's. And his voice was bad. And he said, I got the shakes. And he's got vertigo. that I keep falling over. I said, wow. I said, well, what do you think? You think God could heal that in 1 or 2 seconds? He said, I believe he could heal it if he wanted to. I said, well, we see. And we prayed. And I noticed his hands stopped shaking. They were steady as a brick. I said, your hands have stopped shaking. He said, yeah, sometimes they do that. I said, well, why don't we go for a walk? I'll leave your stick and I'll hold you. You'll be okay. So we went for a walk. And I wasn't carrying any weight at all. And I said, come around quick, man. And he spun around in obedience to me without thinking. I said, you didn't fall over, did you? He said, no, I didn't. I said, well, come on, we'll go for a walk. And I said, quicker, mate, come on. Come on, I've got a meeting to get through here. We're in a hurry. And so he was walking pretty fast. I said, now, go back over there by yourself. I'm not going to go with you. And he went over there by himself. He was stepping it out. And I kept telling him, walk quicker. Go quicker, man. And I said, come out. Come on, come on, come on. And he turned around. I said, you didn't fall over, did you? And when he came back, I said, your hands are still steady, aren't they? He went home and left his stick behind him. But tell me, what sense is there in talking to Parkinson's and telling it to go away? Like, what sense is there in that? The natural man understandeth not the things that be of the Spirit of God, neither can he know them. They're foolishness to him. They're spiritually understood. Your spirit understands. My spirit understands this, that if the mighty God has come and joined himself to my spirit, then the mighty God can do anything. With God, no thing at all shall be impossible. Luke 1:37, I believe. But Mark 9:23 says, all things are possible to him who believes. So if I can find faith in my heart, why, then there's nothing to stop the God who dwells within me and dwells round about me to flow through me and to touch people. It makes perfect sense to my spirit. Perfect sense. So I'd be a fool here tonight to walk in my naturalness, where it'd all be silly. I'm going to walk in the Spirit, for I am a spirit. And the Spirit of the living God lives in me, and he's joined himself to my spirit. 1 Corinthians 6:17. And he said he'd never leave me, nor would he ever forsake me. So if my feelings tell me he's gone, my feelings are liars. But they're natural. My natural feelings understandeth not, nor can they know them. So your natural feelings will do all sorts of stuff. Tell them to go on a holiday while you get in the Spirit. I hope that all makes sense to you.